हाय फ्रेंड्स, आई प्रॉमिस यू दिस इज़ द डेफिनेटली प्रॉबली द मोस्ट इम्पॉर्टेंट वीडियो आई एम गोइंग टू मेक इन दिस सीरीज। नाउ यू वुड बी वंडरिंग इफ दिस इज द मोस्ट इम्पॉर्टेंट स्टोरी आई हैड टू टेल, व्हाई हैव आई नॉट स्पोकन अबाउट दिस अर्लियर व्हाइल आई बी मेकिंग अदर वीडियोज। फॉर अ सिंपल रीजन दैट समटाइम्स यू थिंक दैट यू एंड अदर्स अराउंड यू नो दिस स्टोरी नाउ, सो यू अज्यूम दैट एवरीवन नोज दिस and you think, well, there is already been enough has been said about this story, so I should not waste my time making this video, I should talk about some lesser known stories. But then when you encounter many people brainwashed about Indian history, that you realize that even this important story, the way it was presented to us in our history textbooks, has been so badly told that still many don't know. So I just have a simple request to you, specifically for this video, please watch it till the end. Even if you know the crux of the story, there may be many facts about the story that you would not know. Okay? And it is important that you, and from you, every patriotic Indian must know about this. There must be an open discussion, and historians are free to have pro and con points about these and counter them, but at least speak about them. Let's begin this, one of the most important aspects of our history. And in this, I shall also cover to you, and you shall also realize why the history that has been played around with is so important. Shall we begin? The story is about Sikandar, or Alexander as we call it, and Dhanananda, the last of the Nanda kings. Now, how do you recall the story about what happened to Alexander in India? Of course, we all know that Alexander fought Porus. All of us have heard that story. Now, why did Alexander leave India? I recall in my textbooks very clearly that the major part told was, look, Alexander's army revolted. They said, it's been so many years since we have been away from our homes. They had traveled halfway across the world, conquering, you know, Persia and this and that, and they had reached here and they were very, very homesick. Somewhere in the corner, they said, also there were a lot of battles left when, you know, Nanda Empire, etc., etc. Also, note how they play with you. The main reason that remains with you is Alexander's army was tired. Okay, now look at what Greek historians have to say. We will not go with what Indians say. We will talk about Curtius, Diodocus, and the famous Plutarch, who wrote after a few hundred years after Alexander. One of the most respected of the Greeks, right? Let's hear what they said. Of course, Alexander fought Porus. Everyone knows it was a very, very tough battle. Porus really, and many of the other kings around him also gave very fierce battles to Alexander. The point that must be remembered is, Porus was the ruler of a very small portion in Punjab, a very small kingdom. So the fact that is skipped is that it was the mighty Alexander fighting a king of a very small kingdom in Punjab. Okay. By the way, Porus is the anglicized version of what probably is King Purushottam. The point is that Greek historians traveling then with the Alexander, when they discussed with locals, they came back and told Alexander that this is nothing. The mighty Indian Empire is the Nanda Empire, and Dhanananda has more than 2 lakh infantry, some 20,000, 30,000 odd cavalry. Plutarch says, later describes some 8,000 or 6,000 elephants, and some 2,000 or 6,000 chariots. Now, later historians have said that probably the numbers given to Alexander by the historians accompanying him were exaggerated, because probably the locals exaggerated it. Now, Alexander, if I assume he's a world conqueror, could not have been a fool. Everyone knows that local population tended to exaggerate. They could have done it in innocence, but if they did it deliberately, as they would have a motive, right? They would not want a foreign conqueror coming. I must say, they served in a way you can say patriotically to India in a way. Okay, though historians would say no, those time people did not understand these things. That's okay, but they helped because they exaggerated, and Alexander and especially his army got real scared because with these numbers it meant that the Nanda kings had an army 5 times the size of Alexander's army. Now some of our historians give a justification that that's okay. Alexander should not have been bothered by that because he had fought armies larger than his in Persia. What they don't tell you is this: the Greeks had always encountered the Egyptians and the Persians. They knew enough about their military tactics, their army, etc., etc. There's a long history of fights between them even before Alexander. So Alexander knew their fighting styles, Alexander knew their bravery, everything he knew inside out, even their politics. He had no idea about India and how Indians fight and the Nanda Empire, nothing. And Alexander was a young person of 30 odd years. So he may be ready, glory or nothing. But the people in his army, the generals, the common soldier was really scared. Imagine this small king called Porus had almost defeated them. What will they do? What will happen when they face the brave Indians of the Indo-Gangetic Plains in an army which is 5 times theirs? So, in all probability, the biggest reason for them turning around was that they got scared. The world-conquering Greek army got scared of Indians. The other reasons can be, of course, that they were homesick. So, you see how it plays. Let me ask you a simple question. If a bully on a road goes around beating many people your age, finally when he comes to you and he looks at you and turns around and goes away, will you go around saying, oh, his mother must have called, or somebody else, oh, maybe he had some other work? No, you would say he ran because he saw me, got scared. But in India's case, no, I don't think he could have got scared of Indians. How can we admit that? Why? Because our history was written in colonial times. The British who carry the legacy of the European Greeks, because that's their legacy, right? Will they ever admit that their greatest conqueror Alexander ran away from India? What would happen to the prestige of the greatest conqueror of all time? Who's even respected in the Middle East, who's respected in the Europe, everywhere. If the man who could clearly demolish larger Persian armies ran away from India. But we as Indians will not seek glory here. There are two further reasons why this is extremely important, if not one of the most important stories to be ever told to Indians. Two reasons. First and foremost, as I pointed out to you, that speaks volumes of the power of the Nanda Empire. Now, one more thing is there. You see, a lot of Indians say, and that's been brain faded with them. Look, we were earlier warriors, but over the centuries, specifically a lot of, you can say, non-violence crept into our religion through Buddhism, etc., Jainism. Here is a point. The Buddha, even by Western sources, were at least 300 years before Alexander. And today, Indian sources probably claim that even that is less. They were probably much more 100 years before. So 300 years and a lot of Buddhism had already spread. That did not make us any, less strong. After the Mauryan Empire, and they say, no, Ashoka spread it, and then became, immediately after Ashoka came Pushpamitra Chung, and the Sakas had invaded in a few years, and we pushed back the Sakas decisively, the invading Sakas from Central Asia. We had the Gupta Empire consolidation. We had Lalitaditya. We had so many kings. Where is the account of Indians being less strong? it took a huge amount of invasions from, Central Asia, the Turks, the Afghans, the Persians, everybody, to finally subjugate us in the last 1000 years. So let's get that fact correct. We need to understand this. The second aspect that we need to understand it is, there is a reason why the British start our major empires from the Mauryan Empire, because that starts immediately after Alexander goes. Immediately a few years within the few years of Alexander going, the Nanda Empire is toppled by Chanakya and Chandragupta Maurya, founding the Mauryan Empire. Now they are okay with the Mauryan Empire and Chandragupta Maurya and Ashoka, because at least that can be dated, as per them, mind you, not even as per the Indian historians. Indian historians again claim this, that Chandragupta Maurya was older than this. But at least as per the Greek records, the Mauryan Empire started after Alexander. So the best they can give you is, okay, your first big empire started after our peak of our Greek Empire. To admit the Nanda Empire was extremely powerful, to admit that there was Ajatshatru even before all of this, how can they admit that? Even if they admit, okay, there was a Vedic culture and all, they are forced to say, no, Indians are small city-states, small kingdoms, blah, blah. To admit that you had a huge empires, even before the mighty Greek so-called conquering, how can they admit it? And then tell Indians that we didn't know anything. Think about it. That is why the Nanda Empire is important. To tell the world, sorry boss, before your tiny Mr. Alexander went around the world and conquering the Persians and all and claiming himself to be a world conqueror, we had mightier empires than this, but we did not bother to conquer the other parts for a simple reason. We ourselves had for much more richer. Why would we go around conquering places in Central Asia, tribes in Central Asia? They were extremely poor then. It is in those times poorer tribes that tried to conquer richer cities. That is why we did not set out to conquer your places. I hope I have been able to drill this point. There needs to be more factual discussion on this. Absolutely. More information should be dug out. More analysis should be done from an Indian point of view. Indian historians have not done it. All of us are just readers and lovers of history. But at least a debate must be initiated, and historians can tell us exact facts, figures and numbers so that we can understand. Thank you, and discuss these points with everyone you know. Bye.